Good evening. I'd like to call to order the February 25th meeting of the Milton School Committee. Please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I have a few edits to our agenda for tonight. We're going to pull back the revised fees that we have here, and we'll be receiving. Right, we're gonna receive a copy of those tonight and have a vote on those. We're also going to remove the off-site solar purchase agreement, and we're going to move health and wellness from this meeting's agenda to next meeting. Are there any further additions or corrections? Hearing none, we'll accept this agenda as written. Do we have anyone for citizen speak?
Nope.
Okay, thank you. I'll entertain a motion to approve the minutes of the December 16th, 2013 school committee meeting.
So moved.
Second.
By Mr. Walker, seconded by Mr. Zulis. Are there any additions or corrections?
I have one question at the very end. And this is discussion of the advancement budget. This may be a question for Ms. Downs. It says Ms. Kelly requested that the great advancement budget be added. Was she referring to how good it was?
How good it was, I think.
Is that correct, Ms. Downs?
Where are you?
The last page.
Under
the vote. Ms. Kelly requested that the great advancement budget. Okay, I'm good.
Any further edits? All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. We'll move right into the superintendent's report. Ms. Gormley.
Thank you, Chairman Sheridan. Before we turn and go to the Cunningham Site Council, our high school representatives, two of them have to leave to go bake in preparation for a bake sale at tomorrow night's play. So I asked them to share about the play. What better source to hear about tomorrow night's Milton High School play than from members of the crew and staff?
Hi. Tomorrow at 7 o'clock in the Milton High School auditorium, Rabbit Hole will be taking place, which is a play that the drama club at the high school will be competing with at the 2014 festival competition, and it's going to be a great time. So if you can make it, we'd love it. And
tickets are $5 for students and $10 for adults, and I hope you all come.
And you're competing. Talk about maybe Saturday where you're going to be competing.
I can't pronounce the town.
Tewksbury.
Yeah, I always mispronounce that. So we will be competing against about 8 or 9 other high schools with 40-minute shows. And throughout the whole day, we get to see all these shows and meet different high schoolers from their drama club. And then we get awards for, you know, acting or setting, the sets or the lights. And then 3 schools from that competition will move forward to compete the next weekend against other schools throughout the state. So...
We're very proud of you. Best of luck.
Thank you.
So now I'm going to turn over to Principal Jonathan Redden and to do the introductions and with the Cunningham Site Council presentation. Lots of anticipation.
Good evening. I think so. Welcome. We actually got to do it a little differently. We're going to have someone else introduce our great site council. I'm going to give a cue because our remote's broken, so when it's time to switch sides, we'll get through this. Will be wondering. I'm going to hand it up.
Hi, I'm Frank Graham. I'm a parent, so I'm a parent rep. I have a kindergarten.
This is my first year with the site council. I set the agendas for the meetings, and they're once or twice a month, depending on need. And we, in between, stay in touch with Google. Right here is Janice Gordon, who is our Spanish teacher. Stephanie O'Keefe, who's a parent rep and PTO extraordinaire. John Redden, principal, leader. And let me get yours. Nicole Young, second grade, and she was hired, we want to point out, last year by the site council with her, after her interview. And Roberta Williams is our special education teacher for fourth and fifth grades. And who's next? Marion Krakauer, who's our second grade French teacher. And we got Sarah Callahan working the machinery. She's our parent rep of a kindergartner as well. I'm going to turn it over.
Absent today.
Oh, and yes, absent is Kathy Mulligan, who is our kindergarten teacher and teacher rep.
Hi. I just wanted to tell you a little bit about the general goals of our school site council. We mainly work to collaborate between parents, teachers, administrators, and now students. There's a fifth grade leadership team comprised of fifth grade students that meet with Mr. Redden on a weekly basis, and they're currently working on a catchy motto to kind of identify themselves. So we will get their input. We'll take their input as well during our meetings. We also like to promote an understanding and awareness of the school improvement goals for Cunningham School. Some of those goals include optimizing the use of classroom assessment to drive the instruction, so kind of start where, look and see what's happening in the classroom and then decide where we want to go and begin with that goal in mind. Also supporting and strengthening the units of study in literacy, especially early literacy in the younger grades, and strengthening support to provide for at-risk students or students who are identified as failing to make progress. And we also like to strive to identify and share best classroom practices to help promote awareness and consistency across the school. We also advise the principal, Mr. Redden, on the use of resources for hiring and planning, and we make recommendations for the PTO funds to direct those funds towards our goals for the implementation of the school improvement goals.
And we want to say, most importantly, we do all of our work keeping in mind what the academic goals and priorities are of Cunningham and how these are being monitored and measured throughout the year. Early in the year, as a site council, we were introduced to the district-wide elementary initiatives, which focus, as you guys know, on early literacy, closing the proficiency gap, and advancing science and STEM. As a group, we have a strong understanding of what those initiatives look like at Cunningham specifically and what is being accomplished every day to foster them through various technology enhancements, the robust assessments practices that we have in place, and through ever-expanding instructional practices and new curriculum. For our presentation tonight, we're going to review the work we have done, which has resulted in the expansion of great things that are already happening at Cunningham and the creation of new ideas. As a site council for us, this process involves discussions, asking and answering questions, and supporting the actual implementation in the school.
So as Stephanie just alluded to, we did start with the data. So we looked at the MCAS data from last year and identifying the grade level strengths and weaknesses. We look at a combination of advanced and proficient, and we look at areas where we can provide supports to students that fell in, needs improvement and learning. We do see trends, positive trends, as we flip through all three of the data slides. We do see positive trends. We do see a growth in fifth grade. We did outperform the state, but we did have challenges making adequate progress with our students that are in the high needs category. So that did help frame a lot of our goals for this year. We want to make sure we better prepare students to be successful, for one, when they enter third grade, which goes to the early learning. We want to make sure we have common and consistent assessments in all grade levels in both ELA and math. And we want to make sure we target that support and guide teachers to make sure they're using that information to drive their instructional practices. As a principal, I make it no secret that I'm data-driven, and I want to keep it making sure that we're making appropriate decisions based on the performance of students, and this is formative assessments and informative assessments in the classroom. So to frame the work, our work with the school site council in promoting Milton's core values, high academic achievement, excellence in the classroom, and collaborative relationships, respect for human differences, and risk-taking innovation. Tonight, we intend to convey how that work involves a great deal of discussion, questions, and the flexibility of our educators to expand and take risks in the classroom. We will share examples of what each of these values look like in practice and how it relates to our school improvement goals. Throughout the presentation, we will reference how the district, the MFE, our PTO, generous donors, and our parents have provided essential resources to help get this work off the ground. All of the site council members are active participants, serving as advisors to myself, and are supporting the implementation on the ground level in the school or in the community. By involving this committee, all pertinent decisions and discussions in the that we have are then conveyed to the community, and it's more of awareness of how you can better support all the things that we're doing at Cunningham.
To support high academic achievement, we have the support of the PTO, the Milton Foundation for Education and Advancement 1.0. Through that support, we were able to acquire numerous resources from technology personnel and provide extended learning time or bring new innovative programs.
As a group, we're discussing how we're measuring effectiveness of practices and how our assessments are used to inform instructional practices. So what does it look like?
In second grade, we addressed these problems by the Reader's Workshop model. And because of Advancement 1.0, we now have received additional support from a reading specialist. What this looks like in my classroom is the reading specialist comes in 4 days a week. She helps me to create reading groups based on reading levels and strategies. We then meet with these groups for an hour every day for 4 days in the week, and we are able to target specific skills that these kids need. We reach each kid about 3 days a week, which has been really great, and we've seen a great success. As part of Reader's Workshop, I've also implemented RAS Kids, which is a program that was bought for me by the PTO. And on this program, the kids are able to access leveled books on the computer. They can listen to the books, they can read the books, and they can record the books. I can then go back and give them running records, reading responses, and assessments that I can use to help me to create groups based around their levels.
In the Spanish classroom, we have decided now to give grades, actual letter grades, to the fifth graders, which is really working towards that goal of high academic achievement because it's increasing the rigor of that program and helping those students be ready for the foreign language programs in the middle school. I have also been able to implement a lot of the technology that we've been given through the MFE. I have an Apple TV in that room, and I'm able to use that with the students. They can use the mirror function on the iPad and then project it onto the projector through the Apple TV. And I can see how we're doing with, for example, a vocabulary activity where they might drag a word or a sentence to match with a picture. So I can see if they're comprehending the vocabulary, how well they're retaining the vocabulary. We've also used the Chromebooks, whereby the students can all be doing an activity, and I can walk around and check and see that they're getting the answers correctly because it gives immediate feedback through whatever program they're using. So the technology has really been a great help, and I think that, along with the grades for fifth graders, really kind of, as I said, increases the rigor of that program.
In my second grade French immersion class, I use the clickers. The clickers are remote-like devices that work with the smart board. I use them, for example, in language arts. We can review the words of the week. Like for the dictation, they enter the words in the clicker, and at the end, for each word, we have all the answers that were given by the students that are given on the board. And we can discuss every answer and see why this one is correct or why this one is not correct. And they can have an immediate feedback on their answers. It's anonymous, only I know who answers what. I also use the clickers in math, like for example, when it comes to drilling addition and subtractions. The kids really love it, and the good thing is that it allows differentiation because they can go at their own pace, and if they don't have a correct answer, they can go back on it. The program will give back that addition that is a problem. The major good thing, I would say, about the clickers is immediate response, immediate feedback for me and for the students, and also differentiation.
The Cunningham teachers are currently online with their plan books. It has been very beneficial for collaboration between teachers and support staff. By viewing the classroom teacher's plan book, I, as a inclusion teacher, can plan accordingly and make modifications to the lessons and materials if needed. It also comes in very handy because I also keep a plan book, and so that the regular education teacher can look online if I'm not available or not in the classroom at that time. So it's been very beneficial and very helpful in implementing the inclusion model.
So we look at what do we do to promote excellence in the classroom. We really want to think about, we want to highlight the strong practices, the many strong practices that are already taking place. To do this, we want to be real strategic, and we worked with the Collicott staff, we worked with Mrs. Sheehan, and developed a template that lists a lot of the almost 30 of the best practices that we've seen doing our learning walks, which we talked about last year, that we brought into Cunningham Collicott. So now there's an agreement that involved coordinators, teachers, and principals on what, the consensus of what, should be happening in the classroom. And now we can just share the evidence of what we observed in the classroom that we believe, meets that criteria. And by keeping the data focused, the administrator can better support the teachers on adjusting and expanding their practices. And now during data meetings, we could talk about things that we've observed in other classrooms and really encourage and support teachers in bringing that into their personal practice. We want to make sure that despite what the data says, we are thinking about reteaching a weak content in a different way and making sure we provide the tools for teachers to do so. And that sort of can now take place because of the continuous discussions that we have on a weekly basis with the full-time support of a coordinator, the administrative support, and then teachers now working together to identify what they agree are best practices. Another thing that a great source to help students is we have extended learning time. We're funded and approved to provide extra opportunities for students to learn in addition to the regular school day. However, we wanted to make sure that this was intentional and targeted to the appropriate students and that it wasn't sort of a drop-in, so a student goes to a class and they just get whatever is being taught. So in order to make sure we had a great understanding of the needs of the students, we developed student success plans, which mirrored the student success plans that they do in the middle school. So we just modified it to the elementary school in both Cunningham and Collicott, and we wanted to make sure we did this for all students. So all students have strengths, all students have weaknesses. And also, yes, using the data, the common assessments that we're doing in class, using the MCAS data from last year, and making sure that we're making classes that would really benefit those students to participate in. And we're reaching out to those parents individually and being flexible with when they offer those classes. So it's not just afternoon at this time, I hope you can come. It's really working with parents in some groups that are as small as 3 or as big as 6, but we want to make sure it's very structured and intentional. And these student support plans that all students receive has really helped with that work.
John just mentioned reaching out to parents, and one thing that we talk about as a group is, are we collaborating with parents and communicating with parents enough? And you can see on the next slide ways that we do communicate. I'm not going to read the slide for you, but one example of a way that we're collaborating with parents, we feel, is a new program we have at Cunningham called CCC, Cunningham Computer Club. It's a before-school computer club, supported by teachers and overseen by teachers, but it's an opportunity for parents to come into the building before school, work with their student on a computer, see what the child is doing, programs that are available, computer programs and online programs. So that's just one little thing that we've started this year, fall, winter, and spring. It's been a huge success. Kids really seem to enjoy it, and parents, we get good feedback from parents. And that was a site council idea implemented by some PTO funds and some teachers, which is great. And we encourage lots of great ways for parents to volunteer and spend time in the school, as you can see again listed here. We do regular principal parent coffees with Mr. Redden. We do joint informational meetings in the evenings with Collycott. We had a very successful one a couple weeks ago. We do evening and family activities. We just always want to be inviting parents into the school, both physically and with our back and forth communication. The site council supports that work. On an every month basis, that usually comes up as ways that we can enhance that work.
So what are we talking about when we talk about risk-taking and innovation in education? This conversation involves expanding on what's already in place in our school and then introducing new programs and planning how they'll be supported and sustained. We're intentional about new programs that we're bringing into Cunningham and making sure that they're focused on our improvement goals. We're having conversations about the impact of new programs like Science from Scientists and the work sampling pilot in our kindergarten.
Another thing that we are piloting to support writing is using blogs. In my classroom, we have created KidBlog, where all of my students have an individual login. And they can get on the blog, they can creatively write, they can free write, or they can write, respond to a prompt that I give them. They can also go onto their friends' blogs, and they can come in and get into discussions with classmates about topics that they're not too familiar with. I'm also working on collaborating with a fourth grade classroom to get mentors and writing partners for my second graders, and that will help my students enhance their learning.
Under the respect for human differences, the fourth grade, one of the particular things that we do is our fourth grade Celebrating Our Differences program. It's a parent-run program that helps students learn about challenges that many individuals face, such as visual and hearing impairments, learning disabilities, and orthopedic handicaps. For many years, we've had men come from the Paralyzed Veterans Association, and they would come and speak to our youngsters and also do a little bit of basketball with them. And it's always been a wonderful opportunity for the youngsters. Well, this year, our parent co-chair, Lisa Weinstein, suggested having our vets who were coming, our veterans, having our presentation the same day as the Veterans Day Remembrance. It was a wonderful opportunity and a very moving experience. The vets were very moved by the ceremony, honoring their service to our country, and we then thoroughly enjoyed working with our students in the afternoon. We also expanded our Celebrating Our Differences program in the fifth grade this year. The students were assigned a research project, and they had to investigate famous people with disabilities. They then had to write about that particular person and how they dealt with that disability or that challenge in their life, and also about the particular handicap. It culminated with parents coming into the room, the school, and seeing their children do a PowerPoint presentation on their project using the individual Chromebooks. In the future, I'm sure the Celebrating Difference program will grow and continue to have a positive influence on our Cunningham students.
So all students in our school, we know, we recognize that learning differently. That's why we talk about differentiation. That's why we talk about so the assessments, making sure that the instructional practices that we have in place are actually meeting the needs. And I know a lot of times I'm looked at as like promoting technology, bringing these devices, and I'm really strategic in how that takes place. So I believe deep down that technology can remove the barriers and create an optimal learning environment for students. I think that incorporating technology can help address some of the things that aren't necessarily built into any curriculum. So no one curriculum fits its best for all students. I think technology can help enhance the practices of teachers as they implement the curriculum. So it's not a replacement of the curriculum. We can now move towards instruction that's geared to how students learn best, a student-centered environment, a workshop model. It is essential to provide the time and support for teachers by other teachers, sometimes by myself. I sometimes have the ability to bring other people in to help prepare teachers to use these devices in the classroom. And making sure that before we use these devices, that there is a plan that has been discussed with administration, with the teachers, that we're using these devices effectively and not to sustain sort of the practices that are already in place, but to make sure we're really thinking of ways to transform the learning that's taking place in the classroom, and that we're really doing things that are going to be measurable and seeing how effective it is to leading to student achievement.
You'll be happy to know we're going to end with the kids. We have a short 3-minute video that highlights some of what we've talked about tonight. Put some other stuff up on the screen. It's some great pictures of Cunningham, and enjoy.
That was great. We're going to get the lights put back on. The perfect way to end.
We don't want to say anything.
Yeah.
Oh, no, you know the school committee.
Would someone like to go first? Mr. Walker?
Thanks, that was pretty exciting. And it's quite a pleasure to see, again, how well you're collaborating and how connected the parents, the teachers, the principal are. And I agree with Mr. Redden. I think technology should support that and in some ways provide new opportunities to think about that. But as you started your presentation, the focus should always be on the data and what the data tells us. I'm interested in a couple of things. You talked about a clear expectations document for the observations on some of the learning walks. Can you give us a couple of examples as to what might be on that document?
So there's a best practices document that I mentioned, mm-hmm. and that was sort of an agreement between the way I did, I think we did a little differently at the Collie Cod, but at the Cunningham, we took pictures of sort of the things that you would see in the classroom as you observe. But for one of our professional developments, we shared those pictures and we asked teachers to identify some things that they saw that were evidence of best practices. The Collie Cod did something similar, maybe a little different, but we brought all of those sort of data points together and we sort of picked out the commonalities and sort of made subheadings for things that Mrs. Concan and Mrs. Sheehan and I agreed should be something that we see in the classroom when we walk in. Now obviously, because we don't stay for an extended period of time, we don't expect to see everything. We make that very clear to the teachers, but at the same time, we want to be able to identify a lot of the things we've come to a consensus agreed on that should be going on in the classroom, especially when we're going in for ELA or math, where we've given additional support this year around sort of the workshop and sort of the students conferencing with teachers and sort of basically the structure, the mini lesson, and then sort of coming back to sort of share out their understanding. So we definitely try to stay in those rooms longer. The clear expectations document, we wanted to, it's similar, but that was sort of a Cunningham thing. We wanted to just identify sort of what practices are going on in the classroom that sort of I think are strong practices and get feedback from that. And then I made the modifications based on the feedback that the teachers gave me. So that's sort of what I shared last year. This new document that we're using for the learning walks sort of built from that. So we're not using both. We're definitely just using this one, but it's between both schools now. So now when I go on a learning walk with Mrs. Sheehan and Mrs. Concan, it doesn't matter what classroom we go into from either school, so we can just go to a grade level for a day, and we can all be expecting to look for the same things, which great. Is...
Just one more follow-up. Sure. The kids' blogs sound really exciting. Can you talk a little more about how the kids are responding to that?
Sure. My kids have really taken to it. They are still learning how to type, so it's been great that they get on and they spend about 45 minutes on the blog responding, commenting. They may only write 2-3 sentences, but they're so excited about it. At home, they have access as well. And over break, I got hundreds of emails saying, they commented on this one and this one, and they're just so enthusiastic That's about great. It. And every day they're asking me, when can we blog again? So it's been really great in the classroom.
That's a great idea.
Oh, and as for fourth grade, there is another fourth grade classroom that just set up their blogs. So we're in the process of figuring out how to put both blogs together so they have access to both classroom blogs because of the privacy settings. We haven't quite figured it out yet. But once we do have it set up, then they'll have time to work with their writing partner or their mentor once a week and just hone in on some writing skills.
That's fabulous. Thanks.
Mrs. Padera?
I love the song. I think there was some discussion on which song was going to be used, so I think you made a great choice, Stephanie. I'd just like to commend you. I think that Cunningham, especially from what I've seen, has done a really great job reaching out to parents. I know you've used Facebook a lot, and that can help sometimes. I think of it almost, you get the word out, but it's those reminders. A lot of people forget, and it's those last minute, oh, that's right, I did want to see that, and people get out, and the more people you can get. So my first question about that was, have you seen a little bit of an increase? Because I know a lot of people, at least PTOs in general, were seeing kind of a decrease in parent involvement or parent attendance because of the, you know, kind of paperless system, and a lot of people see a little bit of decrease. Have you seen any upswing this year with some of your tactics?
So I'll let Stephanie address the most recent PTO night that we had, but we definitely had conversations at the beginning. So I was actually doing newsletters on paper, mm-hmm. which, you know, through the copy machine, pictures weren't coming out quite well. But we thought maybe if we communicated through paper, more people would read it as opposed to the emails. Mm-hmm. So we did both. So we alternated. So sometimes they would go home paper-based, sometimes they would go home through emails. We didn't really see it benefit one way or the other. So I just stuck to electronic now just to save paper and be green. And but I think Stephanie can comment on the successful.
We've had some great nights, but we've also, I think Becky's point about Facebook, we were a little reticent to get on Facebook earlier in the year, the end of last year, but I would say it's been a huge success. You know, we've given the parents a chance to opt out. They don't want a child's picture up there. That's absolutely fine. I think we have 6 or 7 kids in the whole school who aren't comfortable with that. Right. So we'll do, you know, group shots of that class or back shots, no big deal. But people like to see their kids, and they like to comment on other people's kids, and it really kind of creates this online sense of community that, oh, look, the fourth grade is doing an astronomy lesson and the second grade just did Meet the Artist today. And it creates that question, oh, have I done Meet the Artist in my own third grader's class? Maybe I haven't. And so it kind of keeps that conversation going, which has been great. And I think Facebook greatly contributed to a very successful joint meeting we had with Calicut about 2 weeks ago, where we brought in 3 speakers, 2 school employees, Holly Kincannon and Jay Campbell from Calicut, and then 1 outside nutritionist. And we had about 60 parents between Calicut and Cunningham, which for us is unheard of, and Calicut said the same thing, that getting 30 parents there for them is, you know, a huge number. So that's great. And when you're engaged and you're in the school and you see what the library looks like, how that snowballs is kind of what we're working on, and it's been great so far.
Yeah, I agree. And who doesn't love Holly Kincannon? I mean,
she was a big draw.
And then I just had a couple other quick questions. I think the computer club is such a great idea, because I look at the Continental Math League, which was also up there, as something to sometimes draws those kids in that are really talented in math, but hopefully you can draw kids in that might need a little bit more help, or maybe find it a little bit more fun to do math with their friends in the morning and not in class. So the computer club, I think, is the same thing. If you can get kids to bring a friend and say, oh, they'll help you. So is that similar to the Continental Math Club, where you drop off, or do you have to have a parent with you?
So it's an option. The parents can stay. So we do encourage parents to sort of, a lot of that is because we invested through the PTO in a lot of programs, mm-hmm. For students beyond Study Island and beyond sort of everyday math that students have access to. So we want to make sure parents know what those programs are, what they look like. And but a lot of the parents do leave. So it is a session where students can work directly with the teachers or work with their peers on academic programs. And we do it twice a week, and because of the numbers, we've actually had to limit the grade levels, just because we were getting a lot of students signing up. And we do keep a very small price, so we were encouraging all students. And then once it's self-funded, we then can send out invites to other students that we think would just benefit from it with no fee. And we were able to do that as well. So it's definitely something that we want to continue. Looking forward to getting started next week, actually.
Oh, that's great. I just have one more.
Sure.
I just had a question about the kindergarten assessment that you had up there. If you have any examples of that, because that looked interesting, the focus, the collecting and documenting. Do you have anything you could give us as an example?
So this, we just learned that we're going to continue with kindergarten assessments next year. So we piloted it this year. It was called work sampling. So we definitely, it was through the work with the aides, the kindergarten aides and the teachers, we were doing data on the students. The PTO provided the kindergarten team with iPads, so they were able to just do it all in one step. So if they needed to take a picture, if they needed to submit something, they were able to easily do that without sort of going to the desktop, going to a computer lab. It was a valuable tool, and it definitely helped teachers meet and talk about sort of the data, talk about, you know, what does this mean, how does this look in practice, like, does this have an impact on their learning in the classroom? Mm-hmm. I think it's pretty much out there that we are switching to Teacher's Gold next year. So although it's different, it's still an assessment tool. Mm-hmm. And currently we're using the training time that we were giving teachers to be prepared to do work sampling and sort of be the point people for next year. We're using that time now to train them on Teacher's Gold. We're going to use the rest of this year to finish the cohort of kindergarten parents and make sure that they continue to receive the work sampling, report cards, and but at the same time, teachers will be preparing for the Teacher's Gold, which will be in place for next year, which is similar to the way you document, it's just the tool is different. So what it looks like online, what the report card looks like, is just different. But the main thing is teachers were trained, teachers had time to meet, created a common language amongst the teachers, so everyone's talking the same way about students and about their performance and communicating the same things to parents. And it was just a more informative way to sort of speak on a kindergarten child, and we're hoping it can continue to grow in first grade and second grade.
Great.
So this is part of the full-day kindergarten grant,
mm-hmm.
and so we're in a cohort. The Cunningham Kindergarten and the preschool piloted this year, and they've done a phenomenal job under the leadership of Jonathan Redden and Ada Rosemarin. And now that work will spread across to all of our kindergartens. But the teachers have done a phenomenal job, and the feedback was outstanding. And we're in a cohort of school districts that meet and compare and check the progress.
That's great. Thank you. Kristen, sorry.
Hi, sorry. Let's see. Does that work? Okay. So thank you very much. That was a great presentation with a lot of detail, and the song was great. A couple of questions, so I can either ask you all at once or just one by one. All right, I'll just go ahead.
Just start.
A comment. I really like the sharing your best practices that you got from Learning Walks. I thought that was fabulous, and I like the way that you did that. I also like the idea of the before-school computer program club, thinking, oh, great, that will mean parents who can't get to the school during the day will be there volunteering. But then it sounds like a lot of parents do drop off, which is fine. But it's just always nice to see schools that try to reach parents who can't come during the day. But okay, so a question I had, one of them was the lack of growth in grade 3 and 4. And, you know, the MCAS scores are not the be-all to end-all for me. But it was interesting to see that there was a little not as much of a growth. And I'm sure you're addressing that, but I just wanted to hear your thoughts about that.
So one way we're addressing that is now we have the ELA assessments in place in third grade and second grade too, but definitely in third grade and definitely in fourth grade. So we don't have to wait till the MCAS to know if progress is being made. And we actually, and with the support of the superintendents who come down to check on the progress of students, and obviously even a student that is proficient, we want to make sure they're also making progress. Mm-hmm. But right. The students that fell into either needs improvement or warning from last year's MCAS, even if they're making progress, we sort of want to make sure, because we don't know how it aligns to performance on the MCAS, so we do want to make sure, and they have, that we provide extended opportunities for them to receive additional supports on the areas of weakness that were already identified from their performance last year.
Okay.
So, like I said, that progress monitor is in place, and a lot of that has to do with the advancement, and the teachers are trained on giving the assessment. We have a coach that works with our lower grade, first and second grades, on making sure that we're doing accurate running records and give them more a better understanding of student performance. Mm-hmm. That will hopefully boost third grade scores next year when those students are moving into third grade.
Okay, great, I knew you had an answer.
To Ms. Bagley-Jones's point, and first it would make Mr. Phelan happy to hear the references to Advancement 1.0. And so to hear for the school committee and the public the support that the school committee, the warrant committee, and the town meeting gave to the advancement budget, to hear you talk about the reading specialists, to hear you talk about the assessments and the training that went with the assessments, to hear you speak of Ms. Bagley-Jones, another part of the advancement initiative, it was very rewarding to me to hear the implementation of those initiatives, the fund, and that language has worked its way into even that of the parents, understanding the advancement initiatives, and to Jonathan Redden, all children are advancing through these initiatives. So the reading specialists, the assessment materials, I want to applaud you.
While we're on that point, I'd just like to give some credit to the ever-humble leadership team, the superintendent and assistant superintendent Phelan, who, when we were doing the planning for Advancement 1.0, said one of the things that will be critical are the real-time assessments, so that exactly as you heard Mr. Redden say, we won't have to wait for MCAS, we'll be able to know in real time how children are doing and be able to respond to that. So thank you, and you deserve some credit there.
So Kristen, just a couple more really quick ones. The inclusion model, you spoke about the inclusion model, and I don't know what that looks like at the Cunningham.
Well,
not to put you on the spot, but.
No, that's fine. Well, the inclusion model is, as a special educator, I will go into the particular classroom for a given amount of time. It's driven by, you know, the IEPs, the individual educational plans that are written for certain specific children in the classroom. And so if there might be a time when I might be in for the reading class for 45 minutes or for an hour or whatever, you know, we have determined at a team meeting for a youngster. And usually there's more than, you know, one child on an IEP, but I'm in the classroom. We might be doing a reading lesson, maybe in groups. We might be doing a math lesson, and I would either, sometimes you could work in centers, I could be part of that. I could be doing individual, like, conferencing with the students. So I'm in the classroom, and again, the amount of time that I'm in the classroom is driven by the IEPs that are written ahead of time. But it's been wonderful. The teachers that I've worked with, the teachers in Cunningham, in Milton in general, I'm sure are phenomenal. I know from my own personal experience, they've been wonderful. It's almost like a team teaching. Mm-hmm. And as we mentioned, the online plan books have made it easier because common planning time has always been an issue. I mean, it really is hard to try to find time for my schedule and for the regular ed teacher to meet and to really make my time in the classroom beneficial. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we still meet eye to eye, you know, in person, but having those plan books, it is helpful to look and be able to know what's coming up, what's going on, and how I can maybe modify the lesson for my students or whatever.
Does that help? I think Mr. Redden has a follow-up to that. Sorry.
I just wanted to add, I mean, this year, from the end of last year to this year, we had two students move out of one of our substantially separate programs into a fifth grade that are now supported by Mrs. Williams. And the big secret was they were supported when they were being included in those classrooms when they were in LEAP. So Mrs. Williams works very hard and is dedicated to making sure that she makes the appropriate modifications, but not to the point where they can't make measured progress so that they can access the curriculum in the classroom. And another piece she was getting into with the online plan book is sometimes, you know, things come up, she has an IP meeting, or she can't be present during that scheduled time. She can now support the teacher without actually being physically there by modifying the work that she submitted on the plan book, attaching a document, or on her own plan book, having the document ready for the teacher to print up and sort of work, use with the student in the classroom. So those are some of the things that she can do through online plan book when she's not there, but also, obviously, we want her in the classroom because she's doing great work and students are benefiting.
Okay. And then just one more thing. The student service plans, who does those? Who are they given to? What?
I know they're success plans.
Success plans, sorry. Anyway, those plans. Is that information given to the parents? Is it in the child's folder? Like, I think it's a great idea, but what do you actually do with them?
So I'm not speaking for Pierce. I know we looked at the Pierce template and we made some modification. And when I say we, I'm talking Mrs. Concan and Mrs. Sheehan and myself. And we thought about what would be the best information for us. So when we want to form these groups, We make sure that the groups are specific and geared towards specific learning needs of students. Mm-hmm. So we had the teachers fill it out for all students.
Okay.
And had the teachers identify, you know, these students are struggling in the same area, these students are struggling in the same area, or these students are excelling in this area and would benefit from a CCC or something where they can get some sort of enrichment. And therefore, when they met, so all the teachers with their student success plans met with our coordinator, Holly Concannon, and with Holly Concannon, were able to make some of our intervention groups, but also check off some other programs that they might be interested in for enrichment opportunities.
Great.
So, and that's why we were able to keep the group small and keep them focused and structured.
Great. Thank you. Very helpful. Mr. Zulis.
Let me echo what's been said about a very crisp and helpful presentation, first. Second, as one has been neglectful of his PTO opportunities, let me say that I'm happy to hear how well it's going, and we hope to do a little better as things go on. Third, I had the same observation as Kristen on the third and fourth grade ELA. And the other side of that, I guess, is do you have any additional perspectives on what's going right in the fifth grade? Because you have a big bump up, a pretty good sizable bump up in both math and English, it appears anyway, in fifth grade. And so is there any additional perspective on what's going right with respect to MCAS on that score?
I think it's been no secret since I got here that we want to focus on writing. Obviously, writing is weighed a lot heavier in fourth grade because it becomes half of the actual score of the ELA, and we want to make sure that students are prepared to write, talk about their thinking, and including open responses, but definitely when they talk about long comprehension. I think that in the fourth grade sort of, I mean, that in the fourth grade looks a lot different in the fifth grade when they sort of go back to the multiple choice and the open response. But at the same time, it's not an excuse. It's just an area where we need to address so that this high performance starts in, like we said, hopefully third grade, and it just continues to build all the way up to fifth grade. But we've definitely, last year, identified some writing initiatives. I know we're talking about bringing in a Lucy Calkins writing program to build some consistency around writing, but we want to embed writing in sort of everything that we're doing. And that's why, you know, I wanted Mrs. Young to share the blogging and just getting students excited about writing and not like a burden to them, because I know, you know, we're really focused on reading, but we need to explain sort of our thinking when we read. We need to be able to put that in writing in a clear and concise way and, you know, answer the questions appropriately. So I'm not using writing as an excuse, but that's definitely an area we want to work on that we think will pay dividends off in the performance on the fourth grade MCAS.
And then finally, was it Ms. Williams? I'm sorry.
Ms. Gordon, sorry.
I may have misheard you, but you were talking about the grade five Spanish. And did you say that the grades or the no grades increase the rigor of the
grades?
The grade, so this is the new part, the grades.
Prior to that, they had just had an S or an unsatisfactory or non-satisfactory.
I see.
And now we're doing actual letter grades based on quizzes, tests, homework, participation, et cetera. Sort of more like what they'll see when they go to sixth grade language classes.
I see. Okay. Thank you. Sorry, I missed your name. Apologize.
Thank you. Well, I would like to say I thoroughly enjoyed that presentation. And just as a reflection, I think I saw learning happening before school, dark in the night. I saw learning happening with friends and with parents, with the principal, with the community, with members of the greater community. And I think it's very telling. It was a perfect capture of what Cunningham School is today, and I think it's an exciting and invigorating place to be. I loved your student success plans and the fact that you're using them with all students, because that's not typically done, and I think that that's a great idea. We all have room to grow and to learn and to improve, and I think that that's a good message to send to students. And I love the fact that you're using technology. John, you've been a leader in that, obviously, but you're really showing the true meaning of universal design for learning, where you're looking at how all students learn best, and it's not just used for pockets of children, but how all children learn best. And I guess in closing, I would just like to say that one of your
slides was entitled Risk-Taking and Innovation. And I think that that wasn't just one slide. I think that that's a theme that runs through what Cunningham School is and does every day as a learning community. So congratulations.
Before you leave, I'd like to thank Principal Redden and the parents and the teachers. And when you go aft and say to parents, when you go into a classroom or a school, you can tell if that's where you want your child and if your child's going to flourish. And it's all about climate and respect. And to thank Janet Sheehan from the Collie Courts here tonight. Holly Concannon is here tonight in support. Your PTO presidents are here. A professional friend of Jonathan Redden. So there's a tremendous amount of pride, and it's all about students achieving. And on behalf of the Milton Public Schools, I want to thank you. And I asked John Phelan, and he said I could do this. Usually we don't do this, but we won't get an opportunity again. And Roberta Williams has given her professional career to the Milton Public Schools, and she taught at Milton High School. She taught at the Cunningham with me when we began and opened the Cunningham with 60 children. Roberta was my assistant, the guidance counselor, the sped chair, and the librarian. And we started with 60 children, and when I left, we left 690 children. And so on behalf of the Milton Public Schools, you have given your professional career to the children of Milton. And to think at the end of your career, which makes me sad, happy for you, that you're out tonight serving on the site council, bringing the program about the handicapped awareness to the town of Milton, and that it's still alive, Roberta. That's because of you. And when Ms. Bagley-Jones asked about inclusion, I think Jonathan Redden wanted to say that you're too modest. The Cunningham, the Cunningham houses two programs where the children are totally included. And we speak publicly all the time about housing these, all of these programs, and having all of Milton's children with all whatever their needs are going to their neighborhood schools, and what that means to parents. And it wouldn't happen without teachers who provide the education for the children. So on behalf of the Milton Public Schools, Roberta. A lot of anticipation, and it stood up to its expectations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Very briefly, Mr. Phelan and I are going to. Mr. Phelan and I are going to just speak briefly, and we know time, and we have another presentation. I saw on the Channel 4, 5, and 7 news last night that at Mount Wachusett Mountain, they were having the Massachusetts skiing competition today. Four members of the Milton High School ski team went to the MIAA Alpine Ski Championship of the small school division today. Lucas Campbell, Owen Walsh, Shay Rulon, and Alana Loria. Congratulations to those students. Now, I think if you've walked, if you've driven through the town of Milton, or you've walked through Milton High School, you all know that this afternoon, was anyone there? Were you there? This afternoon, the girls' ice hockey team won. congratulations to Bob Duane. And the team won this afternoon 4-3, and we don't know when the next game is, but Maura Downs is putting out on the web and on the front of our website and on my blog, and we'll keep you up to date. And I have to tell you, the girls' ice hockey team has this year a fan that only a few of us know about, Principal James Jett. He knows more about girls' ice hockey and the players, and he goes to the games, and he kept texting us all afternoon when we were preparing for this school committee, so those girls earn deserve a tremendous applause. Under the leadership of Paul Noonan, our boys varsity hockey has made it into the tournament, and tomorrow they'll be playing down at Ulan Rink at 4 o'clock. Tomorrow night, as soon as you finish at that game at Ulan, you can get in your car and slowly, very slowly, you can drive to Scituate High School, where our boys are in tournament play under the leadership of Sean Lopresti. So big round of applause for those teams. those student athletes, and not being an athlete that I keep prefacing all of these remarks, it builds such enthusiasm, such pride, and I say to these young men and women that all of these high school students think that they're, don't they, Ms. Begley-Jones? They think they're on the basketball court. They think they're on the ice. There might only be so many players out there, but the pride that Milton High School students take in other students' accomplishments, the play tomorrow night. So we have a lot going on at Milton High School tomorrow. Mr. Phelan's going to pick up the second half of this athletic update.
One second. Do you want to add
something? Oh, I just wanted to add, like, when the girls' hockey game, Elena Kapolis deserves, like, a very well-deserved shout-out. She was the one that scored in overtime to win the game against a very, very competitive Archbishop Williams school. So I just wanted to
freshman
give her that credit. She's a freshman.
Freshman,
yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's
4-3, and it was in overtime.
Yes.
Mr. James Jett did a great commentary via the text.
They were down 3-0 in 1-3.
Yeah.
Big deal. So continuing with the sports update here from Milton High School. Winter sports for girls track, boys track, and wrestling. The girls track, indoor track this year at the Division IV Indoor Track and Field Championship on February 16th. The Milton girls placed fourth out of 33 teams. That's a big success for Tom Shaw in the girls this year in the winter season. Senior Adriana Higgins placed third in the 55-meter and first in the 55-meter hurdles. Freshman Coletta Leary did a great job and was in seventh in the one-mile run. Junior Zion Thedros placed fifth in the 600-meter run. Sophomore Murray Drumbach.
Sure.
Thank you. placed fifth in the two-mile run. And the team of Adriana Higgins, Emma Predsosa, Andrea Jusica, and Sophie Cousineau placed fifth in the 4x200 relay. The team of Sophia Cousineau, Coletta Leary, Andrea Jusica, and Zion Theodros placed fourth in the 4x4 rally. So big stuff for the girls. They had a great year this year. Boys indoor track at the D4 Indoor Track and Field Championship on the 16th of February placed 18th out of 36 teams. Senior Mandrell Goran Robinson placed third in the 55-meter dash. And my favorite senior at Milton High, Philip Janvier, placed fifth in the 600-meter run. Had a nice picture in the Times. Great young man for Milton High. Both the boys and the girls indoor track team sent athletes to the MIA All-State Tournament as well. Wrestling, our wrestling team sent two athletes to the MIA Tournament in North Andover High School on Friday after hosting a very big and successful tournament here at Milton High 2 weeks ago. Jonathan Carrera made it to the championship match, finishing second overall, and Zach Mazzarella finished fifth overall. Both Jonathan and Zach will compete in the MIAA All-States next weekend, February 28th and March 1st, at the Lowell Songus Arena. So very good update for all winter sports as the season has finished and the tournament starts to progress for some of our students.
May I just add one thing? So those two wrestlers placed second and fifth in the state.
In the state, correct.
Right. That competition was a state competition.
And so Chairman Sheridan has asked for these tournament players, student athletes, to come to see the school committee and for you to congratulate them in person. So we will have set out invitations to all of those student athletes. Very briefly, last night and tomorrow night, if the public is interested, we have walk-in registration from 6:30 to 8:30 at Milton High School for our adult education program tomorrow night. So there are many things that you can do tomorrow night at Milton High School. Tonight, you weren't able to get a parking space. Tonight is the program of studies in the advanced placement parent information night here at Milton High School. You heard our representatives talk about the play tomorrow night. The Dramatic Society is presenting Rabbit Hole. Thursday night, again tomorrow night, at Pierce School, our special education PAC meeting is at, no, that's Thursday night. Tomorrow night's Wednesday night. Mm-hmm. Thursday night, the PAC meeting at Pierce Middle School at 7 o'clock, and that will be on summer services will be the topic. I want parents to watch the flyers coming home, because March 6 will be the addition of our spring conferences this year. So at every grade level, principals will be contacting parents and guardians to sign up for if you want a parent-teacher conference, or teachers will be contacting individual parents. Mr. Phelan reminds me that we have to continue to remind parents at the elementary and middle that Wednesday, March 12th is our first half professional development day. PM Dorsey has an array of offerings that you can sign up online for at the elementary level. But elementary and middle school parents, other than parent-teacher conference, this is a new phenomenon really put back in the Milton Public Schools. It will be a half day. But that's all in the blog that I put out today, and anyone who has any questions should call the office. Parents are continually calling, parents and guardians. The last day of school as of today, oh, well, you're a senior. You're probably not interested in that June date.
Is a junior.
Oh, junior. So you do know. June 24th?
Yeah, I got it rough.
June 24th. I also want to remind the viewing public that thanks to former selectman John Michael Shields, there's an interesting option in Milton. John Michael Shields went to the state legislature to have Milton residents be able to roll up their excise tax with donations from as small as a dollar to some residents who have made donations up to $1,000. And we have a committee of residents and parents who meet, and those donations are all given to the arts in the Milton Public Schools. And so your excise tax, a little secret to everyone, they're in the mail. And in the mail is also, in that envelope, is a letter describing MPACE and the options, the wonderful offerings that those funds will pay for, enriching opportunities at the high school, the middle school, and the elementary school this year. Again, they're detailed in the letter. There'll be posters created by Moore Downs all over town, and you can you're able to support. This Friday, all of our fourth graders are going to the Boston Youth Symphony, and that's an option, a field trip that might not be available to all of our fourth graders, but we have reports from students years later that it has been a life-changing experience. And again, that's just one of the examples that this MPACE excise tax roll-up money funds. So if you look for your excise tax bill, we appreciate the support of the community.
Can I just add one thing?
Oh, no, I didn't plan.
I would be in big trouble at home if I didn't ask you to tell the audience that this Friday night, there's a Wildcat Fun Night at Glover for the Outdoors Club benefit. I would be in a lot of trouble. And then the announcements from Larry Rooney have been absolutely fabulous. Does that go to the whole community or just to current parents about all the sports games?
Well, today we sent it to all parents, but we'll start sending it because it builds to Becky Padera's suggestion last year. It builds enthusiasm around elementary and middle school parents.
It does, but also to the larger community.
Right.
If they're not on the email list, can they be? I mean,
absolutely.
It's just such great information.
Anyone who wants to be on the email list, I think there are 8,000 hits, they can call in their email and they can go on the blog.
Did you say 8,000? Okay.
And with all due respect to the rest of us, the boosters have dubbed Ms. Padera a super fan.
thank you.
And it's well earned. And
her children. Absolutely well earned.
Shared with Roman and June.
In my mind.
Yeah. Shared with elementary students, Roman and June. That's and in conclusion, knowing firsthand the work of this unbelievable group, and one of the chairs, Assistant Superintendent John Phelan, wants to speak to this weekend's Teens in Need.
Thank you. There's a group in the town of Milton called Teens in Need that supports families in of teens in Milton at the Pearson at the high school. This group has been together for 3 years, raising money and giving money out in terms of holiday support for families in the Pearson and at the high school in the form of monies that they can provide them, SAT exams, end-of-the-year activities as seniors and juniors like prom outfits. Haywood Photography takes free pictures and partners with us. We give out about $2,000 to $3,000 a year to Milton's youth, and we raise that money each year in a single event, which will be held this Saturday night, March 1st, at the Hoosier Club, from 7 to 11. It's $25. There'll be ways to win Red Sox tickets and Bruins tickets and some gift certificates to local restaurants in Milton and in Boston. And we encourage everybody, if you can, to donate and or join us, because the money goes right back to teens in need right here in the community of Milton. We're also starting, under the umbrella in Teens of Need, the Peter J. Muse Scholarship. Peter Muse was a father of five Milton High graduates, big supporter of the youth in this town through sports and coaching and donating funds for students in different programs, and was always someone that people could call to get support. He was a large and big figure in Milton High athletics and in other programs as an attorney and as a father and as a community member. So monies will be raised for that purpose as well. Four scholarships will be given out at Milton High this year and every year for as long as we can keep that scholarship alive. So we appreciate your support in coming out this Saturday night to the Hoosier Club from 7 to 11. Thank you.
And if anyone can't attend and they want to make a donation?
They can email John Phelan at jphelan@miltonps.org, and we can put you in touch with Karen DeLuca and the rest of the group that have organized this group. It's been Karen DeLuca, Reedy Muse, Laura Phelan, Claire, Susan Higgins, and Carolyn Ray, all of Milton who work towards this group.
Thank you.
And just a follow-up to that, so if people can't come, like Ms. Gormley said, but wanted to contribute specifically to the scholarship, is there a special place to
they can in the subject section of the check they can write scholarship, and we will put that in the account just for that purpose.
Thank you.
But it will be made out to the teens in need. That's the 504 account that we have with our bank.
And if I could say, I spent a lot of hours in hockey rinks with Peter Muse, and I can't think of anyone more deserving of having a scholarship fund named after him.
Thank you.
And in closing, the deadline for our first grade choice, first grade parents, kindergarten parents are being asked by next Thursday or Friday?
First grade program selections are due to your child's homeschool on Thursday of next week, which I believe is the 6th. And those program selections will be reviewed by the superintendent and myself, and we will be communicating the following week as to each of the children's status for their program for grade one for next year.
And if there's anybody in the viewing audience who has a child age appropriate to come to kindergarten, we're going through the sessions with parents. And then later in the spring, you'll be bringing your children, but you should call the superintendent's office if you have a child, or you know, or communicate with anyone who has a child, kindergarten appropriate age for kindergarten screening. Thank you.
Thanks. Mike, did you have anything you wanted to add to those? I'm sorry, Mr. Carter.
Oh, no. I'm sorry.
Okay. Thank you.
All
right, thanks. Thank you, Superintendent Gormley. We'll move into the chairman's report, and our first agenda item is to have an update from our facilities committee, consolidated facilities, I'm sorry. And we have Bill Ritchie and Bob Mayhew to join us here this evening. Thank you. Welcome.
Glad
welcome.
I don't think we got a packet. I think it was like standard pictures this time.
We have them.
We couldn't get it on.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Two packets.
Two of the busiest men in Milton.
We're busy. Well, it's a busy environment.
Bill also sits on the facilities subcommittee of the school committee and is with Glenn and
facility subcommittee, traffic committee, energy committee, MECP committee,
capital improvement planning committee,
a lot of committees,
collective bargaining team,
security.
Thank you. I mean, so again, every year, I keep just trying to update my PowerPoint.
Is that better there?
Yeah, so yeah. So this is the PowerPoint I've been using, from year to year. I keep updating it as things change and different pictures and different projects. I think it's either way to follow. So, you know, a lot of people ask, you know, like, what is consolidated facilities? I won't read through all the different items, but, you know, this is a list of all the things that consolidated facilities does. It's actually like a job description of what department does. And it's just not me or Bob. It's, you know, all the workers. You know, we do a multiple of things. We, you know, oversee and operate and maintain school and town buildings. We do project management, preventive maintenance, information of personnel, oversight custodians and contract cleaning, capital planning, life cycle analysis, procurement of goods and services, vendor consolidation, integrated pest management, yearly inspections, quarterly fire generator sprinkler inspections, green cleaning programs, environmental health and safety inspections. So that's just this is a small snapshot of actually what the department does. The current goals of the consolidated facilities, you know, we like to continue to evaluate and consolidate vendors' contracts, efficiencies. We started out 3 years ago with roughly about 32 vendors. We're down to 16. So as years go on, I try to consolidate them and get a better bang for the buck. We want to continue to reduce energy consumption by performing audits and receiving energy grants from utilities. The grants that we get help us with new equipment and upgrades on controls. We want to continue to train our in-house staff in order to maintain our electrical systems, plumbing, heating, ventilation systems, as well as roofing, door hardware, and life safety systems. This is a list right here. The list next is major capital projects completed in 2013. We finally finished the three phases of all the rooftop ducktops on the high school. It was about 2.5 year project. In September, we finally wrapped up the project. We first estimated the project to be about close to $680,000. I think we came in about $640,000 is because I did half the architectural services myself. I didn't have to hire an architect full-time. They did a part-time. I did a part-time. So we're after, you know, able to bring that budget, you know, about $40,000 less. Brooksfield project, the turf replacement, we completed that in August. We first estimated that project to be about $500,000. We came in about $450,000. I did a lot of project management myself. I did not hire an architect to do that project. So we can save a lot of money by doing a lot of things in-house. We did some more major repairs to the track. The Capitol Committee was gracious enough to give me about $15,000 last year because obviously you do the field over, the track looked a little bit, you know, so I wanted to paint the lines and do some major repairs. And we do have that out to be a capitalized project, I believe, in year 17. But we can probably get like two or three more years out of that track, which is pretty good. Because tracks and fields pretty much last the exact amount of time. And we did an enormous amount of security upgrades to all the school buildings you know, over the summer. Next item would be major capital projects proposed for 2015. We want to continue to install and upgrade the security equipment at the elementary schools. We want to replace the roadway surface and upgrade the drainage on Lower Gow Road to Blue Hills Parkway. And we want to upgrade the Pierce Energy Management System. These are the three big things that I want to get done on the Capitol Committee. The Blue Hills Parkway project is about $85,000. Upgrades to the Energy Management System is about $35,000. And security systems, depending how elaborate we get. I'm going too fast to tell me if it's, you know, just, you know. You know, ongoing preventive maintenance measures. You know, what we do in the department, we do a lot of roofing repair, we do painting, we do heating ventilation programming, plumbing repairs. We, you know, we consolidate all our material supplies and equipment. We deal with vendor subcontractors and consolidation. We do tile repair, carpet and renovations in-house. We actually repair, these last 2 years, we've done a lot of repairs for snowblowers and lawnmowers and equipment in-house. We have that type of talent now. We do a lot of life safety grades in-house, and we do a lot of major electrical upgrades in-house because we have a master electrician. So ongoing energy conservation efforts. Actually, and this is my forte. I really love energy conservation. So we're currently working with a few third-party energy consultants to investigate additional energy options for our schools and town buildings. Last year, we completed phase one of the Green Communities energy conservation measures. We received roughly about $187,000
157, I believe, is on Green Communities, and then we went, Bill Clark and myself, the town planner, we went back and we got energy grants to offset some of the funding, so we took 157, made it to 187 to do a lot of work within town and schools. I'm currently working again with Green Communities on Phase 2. It's called the competitive rounds. So we look at projects throughout town, and we can get up to $250,000 if our grants are more competitive than another town. So that's what we're working on right now. Currently working with a third-party solar group on a 5 megawatt off-site net metering project, working with Glenn and a facility subcommittee. And for those who don't know, what is 5 megs amount to? It's about 14,000 solar panels. And if you take a snapshot of an average household for about 1 hour, that would 5 megawatts would do about 5,000 homes. That's how much energy is generated by 5 megawatts. So that's a lot of that's a lot of solar power, a lot of sun. Mm-hmm. And we continue to work with the facility subcommittee, members on utility purchasing, utility tracking, energy programs, and grants. I won't go into all the detail, but we do a lot of tracking of our utilities. We track our gas and electricity. The biggest thing we found this year is that obviously it's been very cold, so our gas has been creeping up. Electricity has been pretty stable, there's no way when you have 30 days below 20 degrees, it's been a cold season. So but it's nice that we can track it and we can hopefully find little things that if something goes wrong, if a meter didn't work or something didn't work, we can kind of pick it up. So this spreadsheet is actually done by Nancy Murren, so I'll give her credit, to me. So current consolidated facilities oversight, so we maintain roughly about 22 buildings, roughly about 900 plus 1,000 square feet of space. We have 32 staff, 7 consolidated facilities, 25 on school side, 23 are custodians, the other 2 are maintenance. We have 16 contracted vendors right now and 1 cleaning contract within the town. Sound like a big department, but for a million square feet, it's not that big. This next item here is how we're doing for cleaning our schools. So this standard right here is National Custodial Standard. Most school districts in the country try to maintain level 3. Level 1 is like a hospital or operating room. Level 2 would be like nice office buildings. We try to maintain a level 3. So if you take roughly take 23 custodians at 680,000 square feet, it's about 29.5 square feet. So that's good. So we're maintaining between 28 and 33. What the study doesn't really tell everyone is that this is based on productive cleaning. And what's productive cleaning means that the average custodian does not doing snow removal, he's not cutting grass, he's not painting, he's not doing copy paper, he's not doing security. So that number really jumps up a lot. So I did my little basic calculation. So we're maintaining about 36, so we're doing on a good snapshot, a good day, about 36,000 square feet per custodian. It's a little higher than 3, but where we save on that is that we do a lot of rentals. And when we do private rentals, we have custodians in the building, so they do a little touch-up cleaning. So we kind of tweak that. But we're really at the top of where we should be with custodians. We're really, obviously, if you have injuries or somebody's out for a long period of time, things kind of suffer, and that square foot number goes up. But I will say, pound to pound, the custodians are doing a pretty good job, considering all the different things that they do, and especially with all this, all the items now with tracking who's coming in and going out of the building, so it's a big, big issue. I continue with my green cleaning. I've been here in Milton Flex for about 14 years now. We've won about 3 or 4 green cleaning awards. I just want to, Buckeye Cleaning is one of my bigger vendors. I'm not endorsing Buckeye, but I buy my a lot of products from them. And so we have a green cleaning program, not only on the town side, I just started on the town side, and also on the school side. So we continue to use green cleaning products. And these programs are only as good as custodians who really want to endorse them. So I'll go in, if the new product comes out, I'll talk to Jason Shearer, one of the custodians at the high school, Tom Malloy, and say, can you test this, test us. Now, use the time that I can get these products for free. We test them out. Do they work? Do they not work? And that's the best feedback for me, is that people actually use them. And so thank God for these guys who want to use them. So, but we're doing pretty good with the Farmers Green Cleaning. Next slide tells you, you know, consolidated facilities, the needs of the department. What I see, one of the bigger things we're looking for is a future maintenance department. We really don't have a maintenance department. And I've talked about this with the selectmen, and we're looking around town, but that's a major challenge to try to put this whole department together, that we can have some identity for ourselves, have our meetings there, have a shop, because we're working out of different schools, different trucks, so it makes it a little bit more challenging. One of the things I'd like to see happen is in 15 is maybe hire a full-time painter. And because we do, in the summertime, we do a lot of painting, but that really takes away from a lot of the roofing repairs, because we're really, you know, we're merely man. So I did go to the selectmen. They endorsed my proposal. I went to the personnel board. They endorsed it. The warrant committee would probably endorse it, but it's all come down to money. It's, you know, if they had the money, they'd probably give it to me, but it's a challenge. But these are things I'd love to see happen. And in 16, as I move forward with the department, I'd like to see a maintenance assistant. And what I like to do with this, I'm planning for the future. You know, someday I'm not going to be here. My heating guy's not going to be here. I need people that are going to step up, men or women from a trade school that want to be heating, want to become heating ventilation techs or licensed plumbers, to kind of learn the job. There's 1 million square feet here. It's going to take years for somebody to walk in who doesn't know any of these systems. So I'd love to better go to some of these trade schools and say, who's interested to become a master electrician or plumber, to come on board? And that's the type of position I'm looking for. Somebody that really doesn't know a lot, they can train on the job, but 5-6 years down the line, maybe apply for a license, they become more skilled. And then 17 is looking for a licensed craftsman, somebody that can do major projects. And if I wasn't here, maybe, you know, as a supervisor, as a foreman on the job. You know, they're all, it's just, you have to have a wish list, you know. Next slide is our maintenance direct. So we started this maintenance direct program, School Dude, about 2 years ago. We just, I think just the other day, Diane is my office assistant, who does a lot of the School Dude. She puts all the information into the request forms. We just exceeded, I think, about 3,300 work order since we put it into place. So we'll be up well over 4,000 this year. This is a nice system. We can track everybody. We track the hours, all the work that's being done. So it's a real nice tool. This next slide is, this is something that Tony Ciccello, who was a big member, you know, of getting consolidated facilities up and running, always said, Bill, you need to do life cycle analysis. So as I have time, you know, and it takes a lot of time to do it, I want to do life cycle analysis. This is a rooftop unit that we have at the high school. So work with a few vendors that I do use. The next slide is how you do life cycle analysis. So that piece of equipment that is actually up on the high school roof, if you looked at today, 25 years from now, it's going to cost roughly about the same piece of equipment. Not technology may change, but that piece of equipment would be about $160,000 to replace. We have about 55 units like that in the school district. And the scary part is that they all put in at the same time. So when they all go, they're all going to go relatively together. So we really, and obviously it's, you know, it's not going to, you know, we have to be realistic. We're not going to be replacing $10 million worth of equipment. But we really have to have a good maintenance department to maintain this equipment, so we can take a piece of 25-year equipment and get 30 years, 35 years, 40 years out of it. And that's the savings that this department can bring to the table, is that if we can maintain a piece of equipment extra 10 years, that's an enormous amount of savings. So other things, so, but you know, I like doing it, but it takes a lot of time to go up and take all the numbers and call the contractors for roofing and for rigging. But that's the stuff I did. I did promise Tony that I would start doing. And these last pictures here, it's all my pictures. So for those who didn't really see what happened over the summer, this was the Brooks Field. This is the beginning process where we actually started stripping all the turf. And that is the rubber membrane that's down below the turf. That's like phase one of it. The next shot is all the turf being all rolled up. And this next gentleman right here, that's the job I want when I retire. He gets to drive all day around in this truck and just drop downstairs. That was a great job. But it's amazing. When you look at a piece of turf, it's like a little piece of fiber. But when it's all done, it's about that thick. So there's thousands and thousands and thousands of tons of sand and pellets that go into it. And that's how we, all that stuff was, you know, was staged out in the field, out in the parking lot. It's all brought in, and that all goes onto the field, you know. So it's a unbelievable system that they have in place. So hopefully we can get like another 15 years out of the new field. That's one of the finished pictures. I tried to take a picture a few weeks ago of the logo, but unfortunately it was too much snow on the field. The next picture right here is another picture of the track. I just want to show the track. So when I looked at this track, and obviously it looked a little bit beat compared to the brand new field, so I took that $15,000 that the Capital Committee gave me, and we did some major repairs, and we did some striping to make it at least pop for the next 2 or 3 years. But that track is getting to the end of its life. I'm hoping to get another 2 or 3 years out of it, which is, if we can get 15, 16 years, that's a long time to maintain a track. And then all these other projects, these are projects that we do in-house and with contractors. This is the stage at the Pierce Middle School. And the next picture is it's all completed. So we sanded it down and stripped it. Get that?
Yeah.
Next one is that's at Pierce. This house, all the irrigation systems. This system, actually, the whole box, it was
corroded completely apart. It was electrical, it was a danger to the community.
Yeah.
And the MWRI, with our in-house electrician, we were able to do it, wire it, and put it in all in-house with the DPW,
Park Department. Yeah, Park Department, and I was going to... This next picture is that's a heat exchanger in a hot water tank. And it's amazing how these engineers, when they design systems, they design them for 5 years. It fails in 7. So, it's very hard to try to capture your money back. But we did the job in-house. This would have been about a $10,000 job. We did in-house like $5,000. 5 years ago, we'd be subbing all that work out. And that piece of unit actually goes inside the... in the middle of that, it's called a heat exchanger. These are pictures of all the rooftop units up above, 100% complete. We'd have warning signs on them that you can't jump on the rooftops. It means there's only certain parts that we can do it. A lot of the rooftop units, you have to kind of get up on them and have to service them. So what we did, I was a little bit more creative. Finally, I'm getting more creative. Put down 3 sheets of plywood and then a rubber membrane over that.
Okay.
Because before, people would jump on it and would crush it. So now it's really strong, so you can open up the doors, and we can probably save, a lot of the units. And that's just, ongoing pictures there. Took a lot of pictures this year, didn't I? Picture happened. Right?
Save space for
the next pier, yeah. This is the Tucker roof, I believe. Yeah. So we did some white knight. About 3-4 years ago to try to maintain the roof. We do have it on the Capital Committee, for about 2 or 3 years out, so we're trying to maintain the house. The next picture will show you that our in-house roofer, Dave Hawes, who's an unbelievable, talented gentleman. We patched it all back ourselves. That job alone, it cost us $200 in-house. It would have been about $5,000 savings. So we can do a lot, to try to maintain the roofs. And this is some of Dave's work as we go on, all the patches he does.
PS roof.
Yep. This is actually Collycott Cunningham. Yep. And these are some of the old roofs. A lot of people think that we do have brand new schools up there, but we still have a lot of the roofing systems still in place. And the reason why we have them in place is because when we're doing the construction, they were still under warranty. So we try to stretch the doll and try to keep them there. But some of these roofs now are almost 30 years old. But we know, having somebody in-house, we can, continue to maintain them. Next picture is just another slide of Dave doing a lot of flashing. That's the Collycott Cunningham gym, I believe. And another patch of roofing. Getting to the end. And then all the next pictures you can just pop on. These are all the slides for all the security upgrades that we did. The next one below.
Motion sensors.
Yeah, all the motion sensors and intercoms. And then lastly, I always like to ask, we have a lot of volunteer landscapers. Colter Landscaping, Eagle Farms, John Driscoll, the Amateur Gardens at the Town Hall and the Library, and Malloy Landscaping. They always help us out with getting free supplies and landscaping. And I also like to thank all the department heads, town school employees, boys committees for their support over the last year. That's pretty much it. It's just, you know, it's a bunch of, you know, I had thousands of pictures, and Diane said to me, Bill, way too many pictures. Like, you know, it's maintenance. It's, right. You know, a lot of our work is behind the scenes, but that's what we do, so.
There's one more big thank you that belongs there, and that's to the Copeland Family Foundation turf at
I think last year when I got the money, I think I actually thanked them, but the Copeland, yeah.
But it didn't go until this year, so we'll say it again.
Yeah, okay. Right.
Great.
So, you know, hope you enjoy it,
Do anyone have questions? Bob, do you have anything you wanted to add?
I'd just like to say I've been here about 2 years, and I keep being amazed on how the caring level of all the teachers and the principals at the school. It's invigorating to work at a place that you find so many people care so much. It makes my job a lot easier, and I couldn't be happier with the group of guys I work with, their talent and their skill levels getting better and better. And it's been a challenging winter with all the snow removal. The custodians have done a great job, and the guys just keep meeting all their demands, and, you know, with a high volume of work. So it just keeps getting better.
Okay. Maybe you could talk about the differentiation or the, you know, what exactly is your job in all of this?
I'm more day, if you can hear me, I'm more day by day work orders coming in, delegating the work orders between the HVAC, the electrical, the plumbing, and the day-to-day repairs, the organization of some of the custodial needs and any, you know, problems that may arise in the school. There are a lot of work orders that come in every day. Schools alone, just because of the sheer size and their volume, are very demanding, and they have a and every school's are their priority. So to balance out the day-to-day and prioritize, I'm more in the field making sure the guys are, last week alone, taking advantage of the school vacation, we were able to patch 3 different VCT tile floors that really needed it. There was an area at the Glover, the Collycock Cunningham, there was some at the high school, patching cracks in the gymnasium floor. We try to take advantage of when people aren't in the classrooms, windows, the balances, and all the day-to-day. Like Bill said, there's a lot behind the scene, but we wanted to get the hot water tank in for the science wing, but we'll be getting that in the next week or so. And we're going to, it's just exciting to be able to do it all in-house. And the guys, you know, patching the roofs, we had a pretty good one at the high school that they had to do last week on top of, you know, 5 or 6 snowstorms. And like you said, with the equipment, a lot of equipment repair too, but I'm always in the field of running from one school to the next school and working with either Dave, you know, or Jim, and our HVAC, there's a lot of demands in the schools alone just for, you know, just doing the heating. Jim does a phenomenal job. Every time he walks out of a school, he does 3 different repairs that we would have had to call somebody in to do, either computer or setting up or on a roof, resetting equipment, changing belts, working on compressors. The electrician, we found a major electrical problem that we had just corrected inside the auditorium here, and we've got all those outlets reworking. 60 ballasts between the high school here and then another 40 at the Pierce alone. Just squeezing them in between the classrooms. I don't want to get too wordy, but yeah, I'm more in the field and working directly with the guys and trying to prioritize their day-to-day work.
Yeah, and Bob also does a lot of the inspections. You know, we have multiple inspections with, with the insurance company, the fire department.
Building inspectors.
We have to, every year, we have to have all the buildings certified. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it would take a week just to do one round of inspections, and then you have maybe you might have 30 or 40 work orders, doors that don't close properly, windows that are broke, ceiling tiles that have a leaking thing, then we have to go back and do it, all safety issues.
Emergency lighting, exit signs. I mean, we just finished with Joe and Jay. Yeah.
Okay. We stay extremely busy. Yeah.
Mr. Zulis, you had something to say.
There was, among all the wonderful things and all the good work that's being done, there was one thing that that concerned me a little bit about what you said, Bill, and that is that it would take someone a long time to get up to speed and get to the knowledge that you have. And I wonder, despite the fact that you're, you know, probably overworked at this point, if there's any way you can do some of that download, because in the event that, you know, you decide to change your life tomorrow and go to Tahiti, I mean, would the schools be at risk because of the lack of that knowledge transfer? Is there any way, number one, is that a problem? And number two, is there any way that we can mitigate that by you trying to download some of that knowledge that you have now?
Yeah, well, one thing about me, I'm a good sharer. And I think Bob, you mean, you know, trying to train Bob and he, you know, and a lot of the stuff, you know, a lot of my knowledge I have is in the building these schools, while the valves out and, you know, all the little tweaks we have to trigger. But, you know, I share a lot of knowledge with the guys, and I constantly would take Bob into the, Bob, here's a set of drawings. This is how it's on plans, but we actually did it this way. I'm trying to share that. But even myself, you know, going, it was an enormous challenge for me to go from 600,000 square feet on the schools like to 1 million and deal with all the department heads. And it really takes, my job is really more administrative now. It's working with money and you know, different issues and long-term planning, capital planning. It's just, but, you know, I'm trying to, it's nice to be able to do it yourself because it gets done quicker, but that's not the right way to do it because nobody else is going to learn it. So I have to spend time to Bob. I need to spend enough just to learn how to do it. But, you know, it's a process, and, yeah.
But you're absolutely right about Bill being in the school system and working here for 13 years, and I have him ready at the fingertips and telling me, I'll go to this closet, check this, can you check that pressure? The familiarity to these places, and that's what you said about bringing somebody on down the road.
Yeah.
The intricacies of the heating systems and how they work, there's a different system in every school. Having everybody cross-trained and getting a little more familiar, having my electrician and myself work with Jim Egan and learn some of these things is crucial.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Great. Mr. Walker, sorry.
This is an important presentation, not only for us to see, but for the general public, and more importantly, the taxpayers to see. Because if there's any question as to whether the consolidated facilities concept is working, I think this presentation helps to answer that question. The best answer would be they should follow you guys around for a day, and that would answer the question. But we're not able to do that. But I think there are a number of key concepts here. One is that we're saving money by doing in-house project management and using our own employees. The second thing that's not immediately apparent is that the quality of our capital planning and the quality of our facilities and maintenance management has improved immeasurably, and that's because of you guys. And I think Bob's sometimes the invisible partner, but you've been a great addition to the team. But if we look at your list of accomplishments, even for 2013, Bill, I think it's just it's the best endorsement we can come up with of why consolidated facilities made sense in the first place. I think to Ms. Sheridan's point on Brooks Field, that never would have gotten done without the Copelands making a major contribution. But you guys are involved in all of those things, and it's all happening behind the scenes, but we take for granted the fact that the lights are on and we're conserving energy and the buildings are immaculate. All of that happens because of the coordination, planning, and oversight that you guys provide. So I think you deserve a lot of credit here. I think for the future, to Mr. Zulis's point, I think succession planning is always important. But I think we need to send a message to the Warren Committee, who has an incredibly difficult job. But you can't do succession planning if you don't have a pipeline, and you can't have a pipeline if you don't have positions. So part of what we need to do is build out that organization, and as you do that, we can get better at succession planning. So I think there's a lot of great work that you've done, and again, Bill, you didn't talk about your role on the Capital Improvement Planning Committee, where we're doing much, much better capital planning as a result of not only the work that you've done, the audit that you had done, and your leadership. You haven't talked about collective bargaining, but for those individuals, like my colleagues, Ms. Padera and Mr. Zulis, you can't really understand how important collective bargaining is until you've done it. And once you do it, you understand just what a commitment it is, but not only how difficult it is to take parties that sometimes have very different views at the beginning
and to reach an agreement, a mutual agreement. So thanks for your help on the custodians. We're still working at it, but you've given us your time there. So in summary, I just think, I hope that we can get this up on the website. I hope that people will look at it and read it carefully, because it's the best endorsement that we have for how Consolidated Facilities is making a difference in this town.
Thank you.
So one thing I just wanted to say, coming from like an athlete's perspective, I would have never imagined that the field, Brooks Field, would have come in under budget. That field is like, was the best thing to happen, especially like for football players. Like, that was the greatest day going out in that field, like having such better turf. And I've got to say, like, traveling around and playing on a lot of different fields throughout high school, we have right now, I think, one of the best turfs, sets of turf in the maybe not the MIAA, but definitely our division. And I think that's like an amazing thing to think that we came in under budget on that, and also like playing two sports on that. That's huge. Having good turf is like, you don't understand it until you've played on bad turf. Yeah. How important having such good quality turf is, and I think that's really, really important. And anybody in the town would really like to know like how we came in under budget, but it's still such good quality.
So I would just like to add a few things as well. So obviously, I sit on the facilities subcommittee with you, but I have the opportunity to be in many of the buildings around town, and not just the level of cleaning and cleanliness and work that's happened in the schools, but it's also evident your leadership townwide. The floors at Town Hall shine. They're polished just beautifully, and I had the opportunity to be at the wrestling meet last weekend, when there were people from all over a wide, vast area of Massachusetts, and the comments that I heard from people that were here, not only obviously the beauty of the facility, but the way it was maintained and kept up. And it's, you know, I think that because we're here all the time, we sometimes not overlook it, but don't appreciate it as much. And to hear it from someone outside, I know that I always take a second look when I'm in other buildings besides the schools and notice it. So I also want to say that, and I kind of always go back to this, when I sat on the beginning of the Should Milton Have a Consolidated Facilities Committee at All, we met for years, and we went out and we researched and we went to all these different communities and heard from how it was done. And I think that today we could very well be, or should very well be, the model for those other communities that are considering it today. So thank you to both of you for the work that you're doing, and you make us look good. Thank you.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's, you know, I deal with, you know, I'm on a certification committee for one of my engineering associations, and a lot of towns are starting to go into that. And you know, and obviously, it's not the easiest job in the world. It's very challenging, you know, and it's not, you know, a lot of people say, you have two different bosses, but you're dealing with so many people.
Right.
You're dealing with the police chief, the fire chief, the superintendent, the town administrator, the planning board. You're dealing with multiple people that have different needs every day. You know, with, you know, like Bob and I, we got a phone call one time with the fire department. They had no heat in the building. So I said, you guys are firefighters, come on, you know. Like, but, you know, you get there, they're cold, when they're sitting around waiting for a fire, it's cold. It was like 42 degrees in there. Or you get a phone call from the police chief that the prisoner is cold. They have no heat. They have a prisoner, you know, but it's like, but you have to, you know, it's just amazing, you know, it's amazing the different parts of the job that you just never thought that you'd be involved in. Yeah, the animal shelter, you mean? You go down there, you know, it's an old little shelter, and the roof's leaking, the poor dog's getting wet, and the people take that. That's a serious issue. You know, you go, yeah, we'll take care of that, but, you know, it's amazing how many different things you have to do, you know, to really run this department, and you have to have a good attitude about it, because, you know, it's, you got to, you know, everybody's special. Everybody is, you know, has to have their thing. So, you know, Bob and I are a good team, you know, so.
You know, we do it with a smile. So that's
well, let me just say, it's obvious you guys have a great working relationship, but it's a little scary that you complete each other's sentences.
It's the work life.
I just want to say briefly that
when we see kindergarten parents, I often want to step back and remind everybody about $140 million school building project and $8 million from the Copeland Foundation. And I remember Charlie Winchester, who chaired the school building authority set, building committee at Milton, said to me, don't ever be a part of letting these buildings not be maintained. Don't let that be a legacy. Don't work here one day when the buildings aren't maintained. And so anyone who questions consolidated facilities, there is no other answer. Consolidated facilities, led by Bill Ritchie and with Bob Mayhew, with the support of the community, is the only answer. This is an investment, just like every resident has a bank account or a checking account. This is an investment for the town. And there is no other answer to maintaining this investment than consolidated facilities. When I look at Bill Ritchie, the only other answer was Bill Ritchie with John, myself alone. And that's a very hard job to do all by yourself. So consolidated facilities is the answer for the town of Milton to protect their investment in their property. And when we travel from around to these schools, they do belong to the taxpayer. And they are the future of this town. And if we maintain them, it made me feel really good, Bill, about, you talk about, I whispered to John, all the rooftop units. In other school building buildings, those rooftop units would have been inside the school, but the decision was made to use it for classroom space. So if you step back and look at the roof of the high school and the Pierce, it does take your breath away, all the rooftop units. But you have the expertise of Bill Ritchie with all of the support people. But consolidated facilities, as far as I'm concerned, is the answer for the town of Milton to protect its property and its investment in these unbelievable buildings. And I want to thank you on behalf of the schools. Again, the partnership with the town, as far as I'm concerned, is phenomenal.
Well, thanks, gentlemen.
Thank you. Good night. Well, thank you.
Thanks.
Excellent, Bill. Bob, thank you.
See us all again tomorrow night.
Yes, exactly. Same time, same place. Thank you. Next on our agenda, we have the Student Resource Officer Memorandum of Agreement. And this is really just an update because at an executive session, this school committee voted to accept the Memorandum of Agreement with the town regarding the hiring of our second SRO, Student Resource Officer. So that is underway, and the agreement has been signed, and we'll be moving forward with that. Next, we have our town school, speaking of consolidation, we're going to continue that theme with Mr. Zulis to give us an update on the town school consolidation committee charge.
The committee to which Glenn and I were appointed by this committee was chartered, in effect, I guess, by the Board of Selectmen. The committee now has met twice.
And the school committee.
Did we charge? That was the question in my mind, whether we actually we chartered it or we just appointed people to it. But I guess it's maybe a distinction without a difference. In any event, the charge was recommended by the committee, as constituted now. The Board of Selectmen has approved the charge. Committee's met twice. We met on the 3rd. We met on the 10th. We're now planning to meet every 2 weeks at 8:30 on Monday morning. Consists now of myself, Amy Dexter, Glenn, Jim McAuliffe, Anne-Marie Fagan, Michael Blanchard, and a community member. We are going to, at our next meeting, discuss the nominations of a community member, and we'll make a recommendation to the Board of Selectmen for a community member to be appointed. Our meeting this past Monday didn't happen because of a pressing need for most of our members to meet on this debt service issue. So we're hoping to have that meeting this coming Monday. I can tell you what we've been focusing on in the first couple of meetings if you want, or I can just report to you later on. I'm going a little bit beyond just the charge and at the hour. I don't know if you want me to, but I can give you the...
Why don't we resolve the charge first?
Sure.
We need to take a vote on this.
Sure. The charge, if you want me to read it.
Mm-hmm, please.
And again, this is a charge that has been recommended by the committee and approved by the Board of Selectmen. The charge of the committee is to explore opportunities for efficiencies in processes, operations, and/or personnel by consolidating and/or integrating certain functions of the town with those of the school department, including but not limited to the areas of business office and information technology, and to advise the Board of Selectmen and the school committee of the results of such work. And so that is the charge that the committee itself has recommended and the Board of Selectmen has approved.
So now it's up to us to approve this charge as well. So I'll entertain a motion to accept this charge or to support this charge as...
So moved for the purposes of discussion.
Second. Moved by Mr. Walker, second, and by, I think Mrs. Padero said it, sorry. Discussion? Mr. Walker?
So I at the same time, as we just discussed, at the same time that the school committee commissioned the creation of this committee, we also asked that we have an opportunity to review the charge and agree on a charge with the selectmen. So this is the purpose of this discussion. I have a proposed modification that I think is designed to make it a little clearer what we'd like the committee to do, and it goes to the last part of the charge, which currently reads, as Mr. Zulus just said, and to advise the Board of Selectmen and the School Committee of the results of such work, which I read to say we'll do all of these meetings and discussions, and then we'll tell you what we did. I'd like to make it a little more, make clear what the deliverable is. So I would propose the modification that says, and so strike from advise the Board of Selectmen on, and would read as follows, and to make recommendations based on the results of such work for consideration of the Board of Selectmen and the School Committee. I'd like to make it clearer that the charge for the committee is to obviously do the necessary analysis, do some thinking, but then to give us some recommendations to consider, not simply advise us of what we've done or what you talked about.
Yeah, I mean, that's the intention. I know that's the intention, and we've had discussions about making recommendations as we get them. I mean, if we have a recommendation that we think that we can be implemented immediately and that can be result in efficiencies immediately, some of us think that we should make them immediately rather than wait until the end. Now, that's the view of at least one of the committee members who at times may be impatient and impulsive in these matters and may need to be curbed in that manner. Maybe that's part of my charm.
Right.
But,
that's certainly the intention. So I have no problem with that language. We will have to go back to the board, but I don't see any problem.
No, I think that was their intention as well. So
absolutely.
I don't see that they'd have any problem with
and,
that.
And just, you know, as I thought through it, when I was thrust into the role, I see a written work product at the end.
Great.
With recommendations.
Well, that's what I'm trying to get to.
Right. That's my intention. And in terms of timing, my hope is to have a written work product, by the end of the school year, by June. That's may be an aggressive schedule, but I don't think so. And to the extent that we, again, have recommendations and we've talked about paperless payroll and biweekly payments, and so to the extent that we can come up with ideas that we think can create efficiencies and cost savings immediately, my thought, and again, that's just one member of the committee, is to bring them up immediately and not wait until June.
Great.
So
just for clarity, it seemed to me after the word information technology, maybe we could put a period, Mr. Walker, and then add what you had said. Is that, am I breaking in the right place just to have the right verbiage here? So the charge of the committee is to explore opportunities for efficiencies in processes, operations, and our personnel by consolidating and or integrating certain functions of the town
with those of the school department, including but not limited to the areas of business office and information technology, period.
I think it's better as one sentence.
Okay. So, and then where does it go from there?
And to make recommendations based on the results of such work for consideration of the Board of Selectmen and the school committee.
Is everyone clear with that?
So, Mr. Zulus, you could accept that as a friendly amendment, or I could accept, no, I can't, no. Now I've got a technical problem. I made the motion.
You can accept it as a friendly amendment.
I could make the amendment.
We could check with our parliamentarian, Mr. Pavlicek. How would you recommend we accomplish this?
Since you made the original amendment, someone else should make, because you made the original motion, someone else should make the amendment.
So I could move for a friendly amendment to your motion.
Okay.
And so I would move. I would. I'm moving for a moving for
friendly
for
amendment.
A friendly amendment to accept the language as you've articulated.
What a team we have here! I accept. I accept.
Okay. So we don't have to vote on the friendly amendment. We can vote on the new motion here.
Can I ask a question before
yes,
that?
Please.
Can you give me an example? The areas of the business office and the information and technology, were those just next on the list, or were there particular reasons those two were pinpointed, or can you give me an example of what that means?
Yeah, I mean, those? Sure. I mean, what we're looking at right now is software integration between the business office of the town and the business office of the schools. There are different software being used within the town that doesn't talk to one another, and then within the school that doesn't talk well with the town. So that's one area. And so we're also looking into human resources integration, because when someone comes to work for the school department or another member of the town, they bounce from place to place to place. So we're trying to create some efficiencies there so that there's some uniformity to what a new town employee gets, whether they work for the school or for the town. So we're looking to that as well. Some of the other areas, and I'll just look quickly at what we've...
While you're doing that, can I just say also, this kind of came out of the Department of Revenue report that, you know, that we all received and participated in. So this isn't really coming out of the blue. It's been something that's been under discussion for a long time, but there were specific recommendations that were made in that report, and that this is the next part.
And the Town Government Study Committee also made a recommendation on information technology.
Yeah. And to that end, one of the tasks that we're hoping to get follow-up on in our next meeting one of the members, or two of the members, are reaching out to Mr. Blake and Ms. Ordway from the Division of Local Services to see if they can flesh out a little bit their recommendations for consolidation. So that's one of the areas that we've moved forward on. So just, you know, Kristen, just to follow up.
That makes sense.
Mr. Pavlicek, do you have anything else to add since you're a member of that committee as well?
We are along the lines of software. In fact, Amy Dexter and Emery Fagan and I are going on a little field trip this week to investigate a new, on Friday, to investigate a different piece of software that's just recently come on the market. It's being used by Ed Spellman, former town accountant here, is now the CFO in Braintree, and we're going to take a little ride down the street and see how it works, because we have the issues with the major softwares that are available, but have been for a number of years, are well documented. But to see a new piece out there, and which has some apparently some real potential, it becomes part of our investigation. Is this something we want to look at and make a recommendation to the town on? So it's things like that. I mean, it very much at the moment, it's software and process. None of these offices are highly staffed. You know, the town accountant has an assistant. We have, you know, three people across the hall in our business office. We're not overflowing with people, but to the extent that we can use our people better so they don't have to spend large amounts of time doing things that should be easily automated, and, you know, can free them up to do more meaningful things, that's much of the goal of what we're looking at here, is really to make some efficiencies. So we don't have people entering things here and then re-entering them at town hall or something like that. You know, just
Thank you. Any further discussion? So all in favor of the motion as the friend, with the friendly amendment? It's unanimous. Thank you. And we really have a theme going on here. We're doing a lot of planning and reflecting in the town of Milton. And as a part of the Master Planning Committee, Glenn Pavlicek is going to give us an update on the work that you're doing.
Get that group.
As people may remember, last year, in the first phase of the master planning, there were a series of forums around town in the spring that were loosely titled visioning forums, where people gathered together various locations, various times to talk about what it is they would like Milton to be. You know, how do people see Milton going forward into the future and so forth. Just a real try to gather some information about how people perceive the town, what they were hoping to see in the town. Last spring at town meeting, money was appropriated to continue the master planning process. We went out to bid for some consultant work. It's actually a different set of consultants this year that we're using, and we're continuing the process. And the first event is this coming Saturday, March 1st, from 9 to noon at Fuller Village. You can go there in the morning and then go to the Teens in Need in the afternoon, and there are chances to win Red Sox tickets at both events, in fact, so you can really have a party. But the idea for our spring is that we've been accumulating all the data that was put together from last year, and that's sort of where we want to go. But to really get there, you have to look at where we are and gather data about what the town is and what the current situation is in the town. And that, as you do it, people will find it's kind of surprising. We tend to look at the town and say, well, there's no room to build anything. Well, there is lots of room to build things in Milton. It's kind of surprising. But, you know, there are lots of properties of good size that, if they were sold, could turn into a large development and so forth. And that's not generally how you consider it. You should generally think of looking for open land. And so The first event here is really to summarize the work of last spring, get people together, say, you know, is there anything missing from this? Is this really the vision we want to look at? And here's the first situation of our analysis of where we are. We have maps of where, you know, potential properties are that might be useful for development. This has to do with everything from not just development, but planning, you know, on a large level of how we want the town to be, whether it's traffic, whether it's, you know, you can name all the different events, whether it's recreation, whether it's historical features, what it is that you're trying to preserve about Milton, or what it is you're trying to change about Milton. And so there's a sort of initial offering this Saturday morning, 9 to noon at Fuller Village, March 1st. Following that, there'll be three targeted discussions on focus areas. One, the end of March, March 25th, at the Tucker. That's an evening one. There'll be one April 10th at Cunningham Hall, another evening one, and another April 15th location still to be announced. But these will be sort of roundtable discussions on what, you know, the situation in Milton and how we want to get from where we are to what we want to be. The goal of this is that over the summer we'll be working on this. There'll be a big open house in June, on June 14th. The consultants will take all this back, work on it over the summer with the committee. We plan to have recommendations for fall town meeting involving zoning changes or things that might be necessary in order to make it possible to do the sorts of things that the town seems to want to do. There'll be a big forum in the fall, in September, prior to the October town meeting, to talk about it. But the goal of the committee is actually to have recommendations in place, and we would have to have them by August in order to make time for October town meeting and for consideration by other boards like the planning board and so forth. So this is a fairly aggressive schedule as well. But the sort of the opening event is this Saturday, and this is a shameless plug for this Saturday, March 1st. 9 to noon at Fuller Village, by the newer section of Fuller Village, the back on Brush Hill Road, 1372 Brush Hill Road. We will have daycare, and for high school and middle school kids, we will have opportunity for them to get a youth view of where the town should be going and where the town is and so forth. So we're reaching out to all sorts of constituencies. We hope to have a lot of people. It'll be, it should be very interesting, and it's really the kickoff to see where we want to go and try to make some efforts to get there.
Thanks, Glenn. I just want to say a little sidebar here. I'm just so thankful that you're still at this table with us. I mean, you've answered so many things, questions tonight, or helped us out with so much, and you play a role.
Well, he is being paid now.
You know? I know, but, you know, he volunteered for a long time.
Right, exactly.
So, anyway, thank you. We'll move on to the Finance Subcommittee report. Mr. Walker, please.
So, Mr. Pavlicek has actually drafted a memo, and I don't see it in our packet.
It should be.
Well, there's a
new summary of it in the handout tonight. This is, but the memo should be in your packet, too.
Well, can you talk about the memo? I don't think
All right. There are actually two pieces to this. The first was a sheet of adjustments to the fiscal 14 budget. That was recommended by Finance Subcommittee about a month ago, at the beginning of January, that involved moving some money around from between various lines following the ratification of the collective bargaining agreement with the teachers. So we had to move some money into salary lines and so forth to properly reflect the funding of the agreement. So there is this packet that you have that has a yellow stripe across the top that references those changes. Since then, there should be a memo in your packet somewhere. It's very brief, with one other change. If you'll remember from the front of the fiscal 2015 budget proposal that we sent to the Warrant Committee, I referenced in a memo at the front of that there was one change in the actual fiscal 15 budget proposal from what they had seen in their earlier proposal back in December, which is that one of our ELE people had been mistakenly classified as a teacher instead of ELE, and so we needed to move one salary from instructional salary into instructional leadership salary. And the memo that apparently no one can find recommends that,
because it's not in here.
Wasn't emailed to us either.
It should have been in the box as well. But in any case, would recommend that we transfer $94,059 from classroom teacher salary line to the instruction salary line for fiscal 14, because the mischaracterization was not only in fiscal 15 but fiscal 14. So the packet that you have tonight in front of you,
and what's the dollar amount?
It was
$94,059. Okay.
The packet that you have tonight that says proposed revisions 225-2014 in yellow contains, in fact, both of those changes amalgamated in one. So this is primarily the packet that was voted, recommended by the Finance Subcommittee at the beginning of January, and the other one change was recommended this morning. So this is just a revised piece. So the what I would look for in terms of our policy, it's the first page that's of consequence, because the school committee does vote line transfers between the salary and non-salary lines of the seven major categories. So what I'm looking for is a recommendation to make the following adjustments onto these 14 categories as appear on the first page of this.
Move approval to make the revisions as indicated in the document entitled Fiscal Year 14 General Fund Budget Summary, Proposed Revisions 225-2014, and in the memo that we know exists but we don't have.
Well, that's it. That's okay. Now subsumed in here.
All right. Move to make the revisions as indicated in the document entitled Proposed Revisions 225-2014. As recommended by the superintendent and the assistant superintendent for business.
Second.
So it was moved by Mr. Walker, seconded by Mr. Zulis. Any further discussion? All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you.
Fee schedule. Do you have a revised document?
Yes, I do. I'll pass around a...
Quickly.
Revised document.
I'm on the mic here. Need to sound like I know what I'm talking about.
We know you do.
Yeah, right. Television, though.
We're not so sure.
Yeah, right. As is our practice, we look annually at our fee schedule and determine whether there should be any fee adjustments. We have, in most cases, left the fees intact. In adult education, we're showing an increase in the per course fees, which is largely attributable to our decision to include materials costs in the cost of the course, to incorporate those into the fee rather than charging separately for those. There's a modest increase in the short-term rental Milton Public Schools rates to reflect the what we anticipate to be collective bargaining agreements that will increase our labor costs in those areas. And in the short-term rental categories, there are fee increases which, in most cases, do the same thing, that is, they reflect increased labor cost. But we also asked Mr. Pavlicek or Dr. Pavlicek to look at what would constitute covering the cost that we incur, but also referring to Mr. Ritchie's presentation to include a reasonable contribution to the revolving funds that are responsible for maintaining, that we use for maintenance, for the additional wear and tear that results from these rentals. So those are reflected in yellow, and we're moving approval that the committee approve these fees for fiscal year 15.
Second.
Oh, I was just going to say, so that was your motion. We need a second. Thank you, Mr. Zulis. I have a question. So when we look at these rental fees, these are all hourly rates, correct?
Correct.
So for people at home that aren't watching, that aren't able to see this, it's the increases range from between $1 to $20 tops per hour. And I don't think it's noted anywhere on there that these are hourly rates. I don't see it, so I just wanted to make that. Whereas,
well,
like the adult debt are.
They are. In some cases, they are. Where it says custodian, tech support, food service, those are hourly rates. But for example, in adult education, the per course, those are fees. Those are
right. So rates. That's what I was saying. The rentals were all hourly rates. It just might be good to note them there. So if you're renting the field house, you pay $250 an hour. I just don't think it's noted here is my only comment. Right. And the fees, yes, obviously, are per class. So. Okay, thank you. Any other questions, Kristen?
It's not really a question, and I know there's absolutely nothing we can do about it, but I do want to make a point about the athletic fees. I know they didn't go up, but they're still very high. I was just looking at like, two kids, two sports, done 4 years, is almost $6,000, if my math is correct, plus equipment, plus what I've come to really realize is that kids who are competitive about sports need to take a whole lot of extra training, or whatever they call it. So we're adding, you know, on more of a cost, and even with the family cap, for it's $6,400 plus, you know, the hockey sticks or the skates or the whatever the costs are. So I know there's nothing we can do about it. I'm not asking for us to do anything about it. I recognize and appreciate the fee did not go up from last year's fee. It's still at $300, and there still is a family cap. But I just want to put it out there again that it's something we really need to pay attention to, because we will freeze out some kids, and we don't want to do that, I know. So just putting it.
And I think it's important, Kristen, to let the public know that we do have those fees, that, you know, that they exist, and remind them.
The fees.
I think for the general public, people who don't have children and might not be aware that we do charge fees for athletics, it's always good to
and
remind.
What's hard is that it's the folks who are sort of caught in the middle of don't qualify for free and reduced lunch and don't have money, you know, up here. So it's those are the folks that I worry about right in the middle, that we don't have a backup plan for them.
Thank you.
So it's just something we have to keep paying attention to.
Thank you. Any other questions? So all hearing no other questions, all in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. Sorry.
That's it.
Oh, we took that off. Sorry. Okay. Great. Thank you. And we removed health and wellness. Is that, that's yes. Still good. Okay. Any old business, citizen speak topic responses? And next meeting agenda items? Mr. Walker?
I have three. In November, we had a presentation from council on our residency policy and on the question of seeking restitution. At that time, I made a motion related to how we should proceed with seeking restitution. Member Kelly thought that there was a potential requirement to revise our policy with regard to residency. Council has subsequently opined that the policy says may seek restitution, not will, so it would be entirely in line with the motion I made at the time. But if, and unfortunately Member Kelly's not here this evening, but if the policy committee wishes to weigh in on this issue, I would hope that they could do it in the time between this meeting and the next meeting, because I intend to ask that the residency motion that I made be on the agenda for the next meeting of the school committee. Second, last year we implemented this tracking list for follow-up items, and Charlene and the superintendent, as well as the leadership team, have been doing a great job of tracking the items. But there are some that I asked about in, I think, September that I'd like to get a report out on.
MCAS,
science, specific drill down on science, MCAS, looking at differences between students who entered the system after kindergarten, so at perhaps at the middle school level or the high school level, whether there are any differences in performance between those and the students that we've had from kindergarten. So there were a few things. They're all on the list there, but I'd like to report out on that.
The next meeting.
And I'd also like to take a look at how we're doing against the what we call the school committee district goals that we talked about in our retreat and subsequently voted several months later. And I think there's a pretty good match between those goals and the superintendent's goals, but there were a number of things that Ms. Padera particularly put on there and I put on there that are a little different, that I'd like to just see how we're performing against those goals. That's it.
Anything else?
Nope.
Okay, good. And we will have the, I believe it's Tucker School presentation. I don't have that right in front of me. I'm sorry.
Yes, we have a
another site council presentation.
And one of the next two meetings, we're having the PAC, Special Education PAC, and Karen Clasby, the SPED director, come with the offerings in our program for next year. And in your green packet today, you have the program of studies.
So, yes, everyone should note that that is the updated program of studies is in our folder tonight.
Did you say the SPED PAC as well?
Yes. Well, what's in your green packet is the Milton High School program of studies that we spoke about last month. Mm-hmm. And the PAC and Karen Clasby are coming to one of your next two meetings, and they're going to go over, the name leaves me, the options, all the program descriptions, all the programs that we offer. This is really important to parents who don't have children in the district yet to be able to look at the programs that we offer at every level. So that's been updated, but that's going to be a topic of conversation.
So we had, when the SPED PAC was here, when Jerry was here last, we asked them to come back at some future date. This is not that presentation, is it?
No.
Okay.
I believe he's in June. Correct. Scheduled again.
Right. Okay.
So, and just to clarify, this is going to now be added because Karen Clasby wasn't on our annual calendar of events, and when we met last week I asked Ms. Gormley about that, and so we're going to add
that presentation in on an annual basis so that we can get that response or that input from that department. So thank you. And at this time, we will I'll entertain a motion to enter into executive session, not to return to public session, but to adjourn directly from executive session for the purpose of deployment of security personnel.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Walker. Second by Mrs. Padera. We need a roll call vote. Mr. Zulus?
Yes.
Mrs. Padera?
Yes.
Mr. Walker?
Yes.
Myself?
Yes.
Ms. Bagley-Jones? Yes. Thank you, and have a good night.
Thank you.